Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Neeru Tandon from Department of English, VSST College, Kanpur. We are discussing paper 13, Linguistics. This module number 4, Major Schools of Linguistics, has been written by Dr. Chhaya Jain, Principal, VSST College, Kanpur. In this module, we will discuss various important schools of linguistics and why and how they work and what are the benefits, what are their intricacies, and surely that will help us to understand the study of language in a planned and scientific way. Modern linguistics does not begin until the late 18th century and the romantic or animist thesis of John Gottfried Herder and J.C. A. DeLong remained influential into the 19th century. Since it is the scientific study of languages, there are of course numerous schools of thought related to it. Here are four of the most well-known linguistic schools of thought. Language is known as a black box puzzle. You can observe what goes in and out of the box, but you can't observe what goes on inside, which changes the input to the output. By studying the input and output, we can imagine what must be going on inside. So imagined processes is equal to theory. When we discuss a selective history of linguistic theory, there comes functionalism. Then American structuralism is there, transformational grammar, standard generative theory, which started in 1964 and continued till 1980. Then we have binding theory, generalized phrase structure grammar, lexical functional grammar that started in 1980 and continued still. And then minimalist program, or you can say optimality theory, which started in 1993 and is still continued. So one by one we'll study, and the first theory that we are starting and discussing is functionalist school of thought. Functionalist school of thought is something very, very important to understand if you want to really understand the scientific study of language known as linguistics. The first school of thought, functionalism, focuses on how language is actually used in everyday life. Functional theories of language propose that since language is fundamentally a tool, it is reasonable to assume that its structures are best analyzed and understood with reference to the functions they carry out. Since the 1970s, inspired by the work of Jesperson, Bollinger, Dick, Halliday and Schaeff, functionalism has been attached to a variety of movements and models, making major contributions to linguistic theory and to various subfields within linguistics such as syntax, discourse, language acquisition, cognitive linguistics, typology and documentary linguistics. The theories of functionalism put emphasis on phonological, semantic, syntactic as well as pragmatic functions of language. Functionalism emphasizes the importance of social context, usage, and the communicative function of the grammar, phonology, orthography, etc. in relation of a language. According to Wikipedia, I quote, functionalism in linguistics, the approach to language study that is concerned with the functions performed by language primarily in terms of cognition, that is relating information, expression, that is indicating mood, and conation, that is exerting influence. Especially associated with the Prague School of Linguists, prominent since the 1930s, the approach centers on how elements in various languages accomplish these functions both grammatically and phonologically, unquote. Now, functional theories are different from the formal theories of language. Functional theories, they just describe and pinpoint towards the various components of language. Formal theories seek to define the different elements of language and describe the way they relate to each other as systems of formal rules or operations, whereas the former defines the functions performed by language and then relates these functions to the linguistic elements that carry them out. This means that functional theories of grammar tend to pay attention to the way language is actually used. As I quote from Ellen, who said that functionalism holds that linguistic structures can only be understood and explained with reference to the semantic and communicative functions of language, whose primary function is to be a vehicle for social interaction among human beings. Functional school of thought describes language in four major areas. It describes as phonological function, semantic functions, then syntactic functions, and then pragmatic functions. In phonological function, the function of the phoneme is to distinguish between different lexical materials. In semantic function, describing the role of participants in states of affairs or actions expressed. In syntactic functions, defining different perspectives in the presentation of a linguistic expression. And in pragmatic functions, where we have theme, rhyme, topic, focus, predicate. So defining the informational position of ingredients determined by the pragmatic context of the verbal interaction, functional descriptions of the grammar strive to explain how linguistic functions are performed in communication through the use of the linguistic forms. Functionalism, we have just understood that it is an important school of language studies, but this is not all. There are certain other theories, other rules, other schools of thought, and different theory, different people believe in different theories. So another major theory is known as structuralist theory or the structuralist school of thought. Let us discuss that also. Structural linguistics is an approach to linguistics originating from the work of Swiss linguist Ferdinand de Saussure. De Saussure's Course in General Linguistics, published posthumously in 1916, stressed examining language as a static system of interconnected units. He is thus known as a father of modern linguistics for bringing about the shift from diachronic to synchronic. Diachronic means historical and synchronic means non-historical. It is the analysis and as well as for introducing several basic dimensions of semiotic analysis that are still important today, such as syntagmatic and paradigmatic analysis. Based on the work of Ferdinand de Saussure of Switzerland, structuralism is an important school of thought in linguistics. It focuses on the idea that languages are fixed systems based and made up of many different units that are connected with each other. When we call Saussure as the father of modern linguistics, we mean a lot many things. That people who started study of linguistics, they had the role model in the form of Saussure. They followed his theory, they followed his working style, and they followed this particular theory while dealing with the theory of language. Saussure introduced the idea of language as a static system of interconnected units defined through the oppositions between them. Saussure also introduced several basic dimensions of linguistic analysis that are still foundational in many contemporary linguistic theories, such as the distinctions between syntagmatic and paradigm, and the langue parole distinction, distinguishing language as an abstract system from language as a concrete manifestation of this system known as parole. One more important thing of sign and signifier is important to understand. The foundation of structural linguistics is a sign, which in turn has two components. A signified is an idea or concept, while the signifier is a means of expressing the signified. The sign is thus the combined association of signifier and signified. Signs can be defined only by being placed in contrast with other signs, which forms the basis of what later became the paradigmatic dimension of semiotic organization. This idea contrasted drastically with the idea that signs can be examined in isolation from a language and stressed Saussure's point that linguistics must treat language synchronically. In 1950, Saussure's theories and ideas were taken by various anthropologists and literary theorists. They have just adopted his idea and put them in their respective fields. Like anthropology also started using linguistics, and his theory, the theory propounded by Saussure, was taken by linguists also and in the literature. And the literary theory also was affected by it, and then the novel and other literature was being critically examined on the basis of the theory propounded by Saussure. Now, however, several critics have charged that Saussure's ideas have been misunderstood or deliberately distorted by continental philosophers and literary theorists and are certainly not directly applicable to the textual level. But still, the theories propounded by Saussure could not be ignored, cannot be ignored. Various thoughts are still being developed on that. But there came another theory, and that was named as generativism. This was another school of thought propounded by another theorist known as Chomsky. Generative grammar is a linguistic theory that considers grammar to be a system of rules that generate exactly those combinations of words which form grammatical sentences in a given language. The term was originally used in relation to the theoretical linguistics of grammar developed by Noam Chomsky, beginning in the late 1950s. Linguists who follow the generative approach have been called generativists. The generative school has focused on the study of syntax, but has also addressed other aspects of a language's structure, including morphology and phonology. The first technical use of the term generative within the discipline of linguistics occurred in 1957, when Noam Chomsky published a book entitled Syntactic Structures. In the book, Chomsky proposed a theory of generative grammar that he called transformational grammar. Many consider the publication of Syntactic Structures to be the birth of generative linguistics as a subfield of linguistics. Universal grammar is another concept propounded by Chomsky. Universal grammar is something that you can understand in terms of that can be applied to everyone. Chomsky realized that there is the capacity in every language that a person can acquire grammar, and that was applicable to all, so it was known as universal grammar. The work of Noam Chomsky became the basis for the generativist approach to linguistics, and it was originally a way to explain how humans acquire language in the first place. But soon, it came to be used to explain the different phenomena that occur in all natural languages. The generative theory of language suggests that in its most basic form, language is made up of certain rules that apply to all humans and to all languages. And that is what I told you, that the universal grammar, that all humans are capable of learning grammar. Chomsky described it as the primary objective of the discipline of linguistics. For this reason, the grammars of individual languages are of importance to linguistics only insofar as they allow us to discern the universal underlying rules from which the observable linguistic variability is generated. Now, in this figure, you can see there is a tree diagram. At the top of it, it's S, then NP, VP, and then D, N, V, NP, and finally the sentence, the dog ate the bone. What is all about it? How to read this tree diagram? Essentially, the tree model works something like this, in which S is a sentence, D is a determiner, N is a noun, V is a verb, NP a noun phrase, and VP a verb phrase. You see, this DN, the, is the determiner, dog is the noun, V, that is ate, is a verb, and NP, that is noun phrase, the bone, and VP, a verb phrase, that is the dog ate the bone. And that completes the complete sentence. The resulting sentence could be the dog ate the bone. Such a tree diagram is also called a phrase marker. They can be represented more conveniently in text form like this on your screen. And in this format, the above sentence would be rendered. So Chomsky has argued that phrase structure grammars are also inadequate for describing natural languages and formulated the more complex system of transformational grammar. There are a number of versions of generative grammar currently practiced within linguistics. A contrasting approach is that of constraint-based grammars. Mind it, constraint-based grammar. Where a generative grammar attempts to list all the rules that result in all well-formed sentences, constraint-based grammar allow anything that is not otherwise constrained. Constraint-based grammars that have been proposed include certain versions of dependency grammar, that is, head-driven phrase structure grammar, lexical functional grammar, categorical grammar, relational grammar, link grammar, tree adjoining grammar, etc. And grammatical correctness is taken as probabilistic variable rather than a discrete like yes-no property. So early theory of Chomsky, it was dealing with transformational grammar that became very prevalent in the field of linguistic studies. And this is still used as a general term that includes his subsequent theories as well. The most recent is the minimalist program, from which Chomsky and other generativists have argued that many of the properties of a generative grammar arise from a universal grammar, which is innate to the human brain rather than being learned from the environment. There is a particular relationship between generative grammar and language acquisition. When we talk about this school of thought, we know that generative grammar and language acquisition are interrelated. It is assumed that during the acquisition of language, the person concerned has command over the particular grammar. He can construct sentences, and the listener can decode the same thing by using the same set of grammar. In this way, this generative grammar is universal and it can be decoded by the listener in the same way. So this is something that has been propounded as a theory, as a school of thought, and it worked a lot. Now let's move on to other theory that is known as cognitivism. Cognitive linguistics emerged as a reaction to generativist theory in the 1970s and 1980s. In basic terms, cognitivism says that language emerges from human cognitive processes. It challenges universal grammar by suggesting that grammar is not something that all humans can inherently understand, but rather it is learned by using language. In that sense, it is a bit similar to functionalism. We all know that it was said that foremost is the idea that the human ability for natural language is innate, while this theory, cognitivism, opposed it. It also known as CL, refers to the school of thought within linguistics that interprets language in terms of the concepts, sometimes universal, sometimes specific to a practical matter or a particular tongue, which underlie its forms. Cognitive linguistics takes an opposing position to the historically prominent position of Noam Chomsky and others in the field of generative grammar. It is closely associated with semantics. In its approach to semantics, it is distinct from psycholinguistics, which draws upon empirical findings from cognitive psychology rather than underlying concepts to explain the mental processes that underlie the acquisition, storage, production, and understanding of speech and writing. Cognitive linguistics broadly breaks down into three main areas of study: cognitive semantics, cognitive approach to grammar, and cognitive phonology. With this, there is another thought or school that is very much associated and known as the Prague school of thought. It is something different because it is associated not with just major one concept, but with many concepts. The Prague school is best known and remembered for its contribution to phonology and the distinction between phonetics and phonology. Following the Saussure's distinction between langue and parole, critics argued that phonetics belonged to parole, whereas phonology belonged to langue. The Prague school can be traced back to its first meeting under the leadership of V. Mathesius in 1926. This school practiced a special style of synchronic linguistics, and its most important contribution to linguistics is that it sees language in terms of function. Functional sentence perspective, known as FSP, is a theory of linguistic analysis which refers to an analysis of utterances in terms of the information they contain. We can approach a sentence at three levels and distinguish between the grammatical sentence pattern, GSP, the semantic sentence pattern, SSP, and the communicative sentence pattern, CSP. We have one more, the London School of Thought. London School generally refers to the kind of linguistic scholarship in England, a country that has both an unusually long history in linguistics and peculiar features in modern linguistics. The man who turned linguistics proper into a recognized distinct academic subject in Britain was J.R. Firth, F-I-R-T-H, the first professor of general linguistics in Great Britain. The majority of university teachers of linguistics in Britain were trained under Firth, and their work reflected Firth's ideas. The London School of Linguistics is involved with the study of language on the descriptive plane, the distinguishing of structural and systematic concepts, and the social aspect of language. Semantics is in the forefront. You can find the three major people associated with it. The first is Daniel Jones. Then John Rupert Firth, commonly known as J.R. Firth. The London School of Thought cannot be imagined without two persons, Daniel Jones and J.R. Firth. Many linguists were trained in the name of Firth. They followed his theory and just proceeded with the London School of Thought. Firth did not see language as something wholly inborn or utterly acquired. He seemed to adopt a writing on the wall attitude, seeing language as something both inborn and acquired. Thus, he insisted that the object of linguistic study is language in actual use. And the goal of linguistic inquiry is to analyze meaningful elements of language in order to establish corresponding relations between linguistics and non-linguistic elements. There is a psychoanalytic theory that was propounded by Sigmund Freud, who studied mind and who has his different kind of theory that suggested that the instinct to pursue pleasure, which he described as sexual in nature, lies at the root of human development. To Freud, even the development of children hinged on key stages in discovering this pleasure through acts such as feeding at the mother's breast, and he treated abnormal behavior in adults by addressing these stages. We also have the behaviorism theory and other theories, that is the key to psychology, that is the humanistic psychology. Just to summarize this particular module, we can say that Ferdinand de Saussure appeared as the father of modern linguistic theories. Many linguists who were coming after him followed him blindly, but certain other linguists came with different theories, like structural theory, like gestalt theory, like psychoanalyst theory, cognitive theory. These were the major school of thoughts, though somewhere they were affected with each other. It was the theory of universal grammar generated through generatist theory. So all of these, they gave linguistics a different field where people can study different branches. From different point of view, linguistics can be studied because it is a science. Whatever you say, you will have to prove it. And the researches were done, are being done, and we are still trying to understand the language through the study, through the scientific study known as linguistics. Thank you for visiting EPG Paathshala.